deliver are rotten and insufficient, that their customers are powerless and treated with disdain. And yet, in Britain, we have state monopolies in key areas, like health and education.
The problem that you have with state providers, especially monopoly providers, if it's a state monopoly, is you deprive the individual citizen of choice. And one of the most powerful things you have, if you are buying a product or service, is choice. If you don't like this cafeteria, you can go to the one down the road, because it's cheaper or nicer. If you don't like that restaurant, go to a different restaurant.
We are used to the idea that government prevents monopolies by private companies. There is legislation against monopolies by private companies.
Because we know that monopolies are a bad idea.
Because the state knows that monopolies are a bad idea. At exactly the same time, it insists on monopolies in education and health.
If you've got a state monopoly provider, you haven't got that choice. You queue up with everybody else and take what you're given and say, Oliver Twist-like, please, sir, can I have some more? And if you don't have that consumer pressure, which you don't with state monopolies at all, then expect bad results.
James Bartholomew has spent the past decade studying Britain's state sector. As he points out, the biggest state monopoly outside communist China is the NHS.
Monopolies tend to do badly. State monopolies tend to do worst of all. We've now become one of the, if not the, worst healthcare system in the advanced world. Worst in pretty well every respect you can think of. We have fewer MRI scanners, by far, than average. We have fewer beds. We have fewer acute hospital beds. We treat fewer people with fewer cancer drugs, and we give them less of them. Then they go to their doctor, they don't realise that they're being diagnosed late, that they're being treated late, that they're getting a poor rate of radiotherapy, that they're getting out-of-date cancer drugs. They don't know this. They're innocents who are, many of whom are dying without knowing it's the fault of the NHS.
I've come to a health tourism show in Olympia. In these days of cheap travel, it's easy to hop on a plane and head abroad for your cancer treatment, say, to a country with much higher cancer survival rates, in hospitals that look more like five-star hotels, and all for little more than the cost of a holiday.
See you again. Bye.
Today we have Saturday, okay, and if a patient is coming here, a British patient is coming, I have a serious problem, this and this and this, he can come on Monday and we're going to start immediately.
Does the NHS go to Germany trying to find patients? Do you find many patients wanting to come to England for treatment?
I think Germans would not go to England for treatment, no.
The NHS is the most monopolized state provision in the advanced world, and it is the worst system in the advanced world, the least successful system in terms of treating people well, and indeed treating the poor. So it is the most state-controlled and the worst. There is a connection between these two things.
People say we need a state health system in order to provide health care for the poor. Is that true?
In Germany, we have a health insurance system.
So all Germans must have health insurance?
There's a law that everybody who lives in Germany, not necessarily Germans, but everybody who lives in Germany needs to have health insurance.
What happens if they're poor and they can't afford it?
The state is paying the health insurance. Even if you're poor, unfortunately, you'll get sick, yeah, and then you get the medical treatment, of course, yes.
You don't need to have a nationalized monopoly to treat the poor. They're treated in France, they're treated in Germany, in Italy. All around the world, advanced countries look after the poor. You don't have to be a state monopoly. You can have an insurance system. That's become the norm in Europe.
The idea that we need state monopolies in order to look after the poor is obviously untrue.
We make sure poor people in Britain have shoes and clothes and food, but we don't have state shoe shops and state clothes shops and government canteens. Can you imagine how awful that would be?
In fact, in our state health and education system, the poor do especially badly.
It's the articulate, pushy middle classes who manage to see the consultant and get their kids into the one decent state school in the area. Excuse me, you've put skimmed milk in my latte. People say you can't possibly privatise health and education because private firms will be in it to make a profit. But we're surrounded by wonderful things made by companies who need to make a profit. Do we say, we can't have a washing machine made by Bosch or Zanussi because they make a profit?
Much better to have a washing machine made by the state. Let's not get a Toyota, they're in it for the money. Much wiser to wait in a queue for a government-made Trabant.
Suppose I threw a £50 note out of the window every second of every minute of every day. How long would it take me to chuck the UK national debt out of the window? Would it be a year? Would it be 10 years? Would it be 250 years? Well, to chuck the UK national debt out of the window, it would take me more than 3,000 years. In other words, if I had started doing this in 1000 BC, that's before the Trojan War, I still wouldn't have finished. I hope you're picking all these up.
We're in debt because for years government has been spending vast sums of money it didn't have. But we are told that we can't now shrink the state because that would hurt poor people. Supporters of our supersized state like to depict it as a kind of Robin Hood, stealing from rich folk like Andrew Lloyd Webber to feed the poor. This appeals to our sense of fair play. But how accurate is this notion of the Robin Hood state?
Taxes are a colossal burden on virtually everybody in Britain. Taxes aren't for the super rich or even just for the affluent. They hit everyone.
The government is spending over 50% of national income this year. You can't tax 50% of total national income just by taxing rich people. There aren't enough of them and they don't earn enough money.
If you're working on a fairly lowish wage, let's say £8,000, £9,000, £10,000 a year, you are still being clobbered for taxation. Not just in your, you know, taxes you'll pay on your income, but VAT of 20% on everything you buy. When you actually add it all up, the proportion of your money that you've given to the state is vast.
It is the middle class, it's the bulk of the population, and it is the poorest who pay most tax.
It's only when you sit down and add it all up that you realise what high levels of tax people are paying. Someone earning £12,500 a year, that's about the minimum wage. They're paying almost £7,000 in tax. Over half their income is going straight in tax.
Much of Britain's bloated benefit system involves what accountants call tax churning. One third of households in Britain receive more than half their income in the form of state benefits, which have to be paid for out of taxes which are often levied on the very same households.
If you look at very low income people, again, minimum wage earners, they're paying as much in tax as they're getting back in benefits. So you're getting this huge churn where the money's flowing around in a great circle with, of course, a lot of bureaucrats to administer it on the way round. And effectively, they're only getting back in benefits what they're paying in taxes.
The Robin Hood state is simply a myth that's used to justify punitive levels of taxation.
The state accounts for more than half of all spending in the UK. And yet the genuinely helpless and vulnerable still lead miserable lives.
The saddest thing is that they haven't accomplished anything with that tax money. They could have taxed us at a fraction of that level and still alleviated poverty, instead of which they wasted on all sorts of nonsense.
In fact, far from alleviating poverty, the state manages to generate more by paying millions of people who are perfectly capable of working to do nothing their whole lives. Nearly one in five households in Britain is workless.
People want to have some kind of safety net, but Britain has provided one of the worst forms of welfare benefits of any leading country. Other systems around the world are much more demanding. Even in Sweden or Switzerland, after a certain time, for a while, you're given generous benefits, but then the window closes and you are expected to get a job. You are expected, regardless of your qualifications, to take any job. I remember it was a scandal in the 1970s when unemployment first breached 1 million. Now, we would consider that a major achievement. Permanent mass unemployment has become the norm, and it is the welfare state which has facilitated this.
Last year, the government spent more on welfare than it raised in income tax. Benefits must be reduced to a tiny fraction of current levels. It is madness to pay millions of healthy adults to be permanently idle. Together with a few million public sector workers, they must take jobs in the real productive economy. But where will these proper jobs come from? To find out, I'm heading east. At the edge of the Pearl River Delta, rising out of the South China Sea, the small hilly island of Hong Kong. This is Asia's Manhattan.
Back in the 1950s, Hong Kong was a funny little hangover from the British Empire. Little more than a shanty fishing port, all junks and rickshaws and pointy hats. Colourful, but desperately poor. Well, it's changed.
The city moves at thrilling speed. It's so clean and prosperous. Everyone is so pleasing and alive and busy. We know you love us and you probably do. The place reeks with confidence and ambition and dynamism. Give us a kiss and maybe we can go out. But it didn't used to be this dynamic. Down below the skyscrapers, a taste of old China. This temple is dedicated to the deity Man Xiong, and it tells us a lot about how China used to be. Because before he died and got promoted to God, Man Xiong was a state bureaucrat. He's still worshipped by civil servants. In ancient China, even heaven was bureaucratic.
Two great examples in history of civilizations which were unable to develop, which failed to progress, ancient Egypt and ancient China, both of them run by vast parasitic bureaucracies. In fact, British senior civil servants still refer to themselves as mandarins, part of the state bureaucrats who ran China for centuries.
To see how quickly Hong Kong has transformed itself, I've come to see one of its most famous politicians. Andrew Wong was president of the Legislative Council in Hong Kong when it was handed over to China.
Hong Kong's a name that the British invented. Before the British came, on Hong Kong Island there were some villages. But this is Hong Kong Island, that's Kowloon Peninsula.
And this looks like a kind of shanty town, isn't it?
It is a shanty town. 1950s, I think. A shanty town mushroomed throughout the whole of Hong Kong. It is Hong Kong Island, early 60s. Hong Kong started big up in the 1960s. I took that ferry boat to school.
The man who is widely credited with transforming in Hong Kong was a Scottish civil servant called John Cowperthwaite, who took over as financial secretary here in 1961. Cowperthwaite was an old-fashioned classical liberal. It is said he slept with a copy of Adam Smith's Wealth of Nations by his bed. He believed the best thing government could do was as little as possible.
John Cowperthwaite was a private man, humble, publicity shy. He'd been quite embarrassed at the thought of being cast in bronze. But if there's one person responsible for the economic miracle in Hong Kong, it's him. Why do you have a statue of John Cowperthwaite in your office in Hong Kong?
Because he's my hero. He set a roadmap for us to go and create the last 50 years prosperity in Hong Kong.
Cowperthwaite believed tax was a terrible imposition and an obstacle to growth. So he scrapped lots of taxes and limited income tax to just 15%. Today, still, taxes are low and paid only by the better off. Most people in Hong Kong pay no tax. The effect has been amazing.
By having a lower tax, there's more incentive for the people to make more money and for the economy to become more prosperous.
When you tax people, you're actually punishing success. The higher the taxes, the more punishment you put on success. This is one thing that you don't want to do. If you want people to success, you don't punish them, you don't tax them. This is the basic lesson we learned here.
So how long does it take them to grow this big?
Jimmy Lai escaped from communist China as a boy and came to Hong Kong with a dollar in his pocket. He's now the billionaire founder and head of one of China's biggest